Hi, everyone. Hello. Yes, my name is Sarah. I'm doing a PhD at UCL. And today I'm going to present some of my work that I did, that I'm doing for my PhD. That's called Betting on Consensus with Fantomets. Sorry if it's hard to pronounce, but that was okay. That was quite good. This is joint work with Patrick McCurry, who is a professor at King's College, and Sarah McElgen, who is my PhD advisor at UCL. Okay. So before I start, I'm just going to quickly do a small recap about what's the difference between Bitcoin and traditional consensus protocol. Okay, so first, in Bitcoin, the set of participants, it's completely open. So it means that people, they can leave the protocol, they can join like whenever they want. There is no like barrier, there's nothing to do, just join, leave as you wish. So this means that the set of participants is unknown. So this is like very different from traditional consensus protocol, where there is a set of participants that needs to be known prior to the protocol. Okay. Also, in Bitcoin, in order to reach consensus, there's also like one message that it broadcasts per round, and that message is a block. So it means that when there is a miner that solves a proof of work, then that miner just broadcasts their block to the rest of the network together with their proof of work, and then all the other miners are just going to accept this. So really, there's just like one message broadcast, and then you know, kind of like we all agree. So that's very different from traditional consensus protocol. I don't know how this audience is familiar with them. For example, there is like PBFT or Paxos, and I think like we've heard about it like a bit during this conference, but mostly how this works is like there's, you know, different phase. There's the voting phase, the commit phase. There's a lot of exchange of messages between participants. So this is really like super different than Bitcoin. So also, how is this achieved? So if this is achieved, it's like mainly due to economic argument. It's because it costs a lot of money to create a block because of proof of work. So really, for Bitcoin, incentives is at the core of its security. Whereas for traditional consensus protocol, you may know like there's no such thing as incentive. Like there's no money. We just assume that participants are here to participate in the protocol, and there is no need to incentivize them. So that's very different from Bitcoin. Well, all of that, this has a price, and the price is the very high energy consumption. So again, I think this is a theme that was mentioned a lot during this conference, during these 2 days. You know, there are a lot of estimates. Like I think the last one was like Bitcoin is like, you know, one million jets like flying in the sky, or you know, Bitcoin like consumes more than Hungary or Ecuador. I mean, there are a lot of estimates, but we all know that it consumes a lot of energy, and that's a big problem. Okay, so now us researchers and generally the blockchain community, we are wondering, is there a way to have like blockchain without proof of work? So one type of protocol that is like widely studied, again, we've heard about it during this conference, is proof of stake. So the idea of proof of stake is instead of having, you know, one miners who mines a block proportionally to the computational power, we replace the computational power with the stake. So it means that, you know, miners will create blocks proportionally to the amount of stake. So this means like the amount of coins that they have in the cryptocurrency. Okay, but can we get the same guarantees by having a system like proof of stake? And by the way, there are like many others. There are proof of space also. I think we've heard about it during this conference, and really like a lot of other, like we call them like proof of X, and X, you know, insert whatever other resources you like. So can we get the same guarantees? As I've said, like just previously, really like the security of Bitcoin, it really relies on the fact that it costs money to create a block, this proof of work. So when we try to remove this proof of work, there are a lot of problems that arise. So one of them is like nothing at stake. It's called nothing at stake. So the idea is like, let's imagine there is a fork. Because miners don't spend like money creating blocks, then they can just like, you know, keep creating blocks on top of every fork. And this makes it impossible to reach consensus. So that's the nothing at stake. Then there is the grinding attack. So similarly, if it doesn't cost anything to create a block, then miners can just try to create as many blocks as they like and just grind through the parameters in order to find like one block that maybe is gonna give them some unfair advantage in the future. So that's grinding. And lastly, there are long-range attacks. And the idea is like an attacker could, for example, bribe old participants in a protocol and buy, let's say, their old secret key in order to rewrite the whole history of the blockchain. And because participants have no more stake in the system, they don't have like their coin anymore, then an adversary could do this attack for basically free. So these are the main three problems discussed in proof of stake setting or generally like proof of X setting. And we see here that the fact that creating a block is costless is really a big problem. So there are some solutions that has been proposed. Again, we've heard about Algorand. There is Ouroboros. There is Snow White. So, however, there is something, and it's not only for proof of stake, but generally for like blockchain protocol, a problem that incentives are very rarely considered. So, if you were here yesterday during the panel, that's also something that we discussed that. You know, there's a big lack of like formal model to discuss like incentive within consensus protocol, and usually like all of the new like blockchain consensus protocol, they kind of sometimes like don't even like mention incentives. Sometimes they mention it, but without really like going deep into it. And indeed, this is a problem because incentives matter. Again, that's something that's we've been discussing during this conference. Like as I've just said, the security relies on the incentives, and also there are a lot of failures from incentives. So just to mention a few one, in case you are not convinced that incentives matter. So there is the selfish mining. Actually, that has been like studied a lot in our community. There is the verifier and the miners dilemma. So the idea is like miners are not really incentivized to verify the validity of the blocks. So that's again like a big problem, a big security problem linked to incentives. There is the instability of Bitcoin without the block reward, and also I think like Itai talks previously about the mining gap is also like related to this. Also there are a lot of bribery attacks. This morning Joe had a really good talk about them, and really like there are many of them. And if I wanted, you know, to talk about all the attacks on incentives, like they wouldn't all fit in one slide. Really, like there's a big failure in incentives in Bitcoin. So, yeah, that's a big problem. Okay, so how can we fix that? So now we need first to have an appropriate model. So this means that we need to consider rational players. So in game theory, like we all only consider rational players, but traditionally in a distributed system or cryptographic system, rational players are not really considered. And as we know, when we talk about cryptocurrencies, like people usually are motivated by like financial gain. So in this setting, it's very important to consider rational player, just like we do in game theory. But that's not enough. And in addition to rational players, we also need to consider like non-rational player or like fully malicious player or Byzantine players. So this means that there are some adversaries that are gonna be motivated by like anything else, but they're not going to be like, they're not going to care if they lose money. So for example, you could think about, you know, state level attack or, you know, terrorist group or, you know, whatever, just like people who want to harm the system, even if it actually costs them money. And in security, that's something that, you know, quite important to consider, is that we don't always know what the motivation of an adversary is. So considering only rational player, that's not enough. We also need to consider like fully malicious players. Something else that's very important to consider when doing our model, formal model, is to consider coalitions. So this, we like see it every day in every cryptocurrency. There are mining pools. People form coalitions. This is a big problem because, as we know, like this is completely like opposed to like the decentralized ideal of cryptocurrencies. So that's also like something very important to consider, is like coalitions. So now, fortunately, there are some works that have been done in this direction in the past that try to incorporate all of these threat models that I've just mentioned. Okay, so one of them is called the BAR model. This was introduced by Jean-Philippe Martin and his co-author. So the idea of the BAR model is that we're going to consider three types of different player: Byzantine, altruistic, and rational player. So Byzantine and rational players, I've just talked about them right now, so hopefully it's clear what it is. And altruistic player, as the name suggests, is just like a honest player or, you know, good player that are just going to follow the protocol. So you may think that's, you know, that's kind of like naive to consider that they are, you know, such type of player, but actually it's quite a reasonable assumption. And indeed we see like in real life that there are a lot of like honest players. So for example, you can think about Tor or about torrenting, but also, you know, about Bitcoin, there are all these attacks like selfish mining, etc. And all of them, they haven't really been enforced. So it's actually a reasonable assumption to consider altruistic player. Okay, so in addition to having this BAR-like framework, there is also a concept that is called robustness. And this concept was introduced by Itai Abraham and his co-author. So there are two properties in robustness. One of them is called resilience. And the idea of resilience is really to like consider these coalitions that I've just mentioned. So because in traditional Nash equilibrium, coalitions are not really considered. So resilience, like we will consider this this coalition, and the idea is like a protocol is resilient if even a coalition of players is not incentivized to deviate from the protocol. So that's the first part of robustness, and the second part is immunity. So now immunity is going to really capture this fully malicious adversary that I've mentioned, and it says that even if there is a fully malicious adversary, even if there is a fully malicious adversary, then the utility of the honest player or the player that are not deviating from the protocol is not going to be harmed. So even if someone like try to attack the protocol, basically it's not going to impact the other player. So as you see, that's a really like useful property to have in this type of system. Okay, so now that I've mentioned, you know, all this model that and this framework that is needed in cryptocurrency in order to consider, you know, a reasonable threat model, we also need to consider, you know, the threat model that is associated with just like blockchain and that has been studied in the blockchain community. So there are mostly three properties that a cryptocurrency should satisfy. So one of them is chain growth. So chain growth, as the name suggests, is the idea that the chain is going to grow. So if someone is familiar with distributed systems, this is the same property as liveness in distributed system. So we don't want, you know, to be stuck. We want the chain to keep growing. There is also chain quality. The idea behind chain quality is that an adversary should not contribute to the blockchain more blocks than what they are supposed to. So for example, in Bitcoin, an adversary should contribute to the blockchain blocks proportionally to the computational power. And for example, in a proof of stake system, this could be proportionally to their stake. And lastly, there's also the common prefix property that is also sometimes called consistency. And again, if someone is familiar with distributed system, this is kind of like the safety notion of distributed system. So basically, it says that participants should reach consensus, so they should agree on their view of the blockchain, except maybe for the last, you know, T blocks. They should all have the same, you know, like view of the blockchain. So that's kind of like obvious why that's the main property. We want everyone to agree. Okay, so now that I have like explained the whole like model that we're gonna use, I'm gonna present our Fantomate protocol. So a quick overview of the protocol. It is composed of two components. One of them is a leader election. So why a leader election? So the idea is like, when you think about proof of work, you can think about it as a leader election, because the idea is like whoever solve the proof of work, they're gonna be elected leader, and then, you know, they're just gonna show to the other people, look guys, I've solved the proof of work, so I'm the leader, so I get the right to create the block. So now, because we don't want proof of work, we want to replace this with a leader election that's gonna create a proof of eligibility. And in the same way, like in our protocol, like a player will be able to say, look guys, I have a proof of eligibility that everyone can verify that is correct. And this means that they have the right to create the block. So really this leader election is to give the right to create the block. And the idea is that in our protocol, it's going to be similar to Bitcoin. If you think about it in Bitcoin, one block will decide on the next proof of work, because in the proof of work, you have to reference the previous block. So this is similar in our setting, like one block will elect at least one leader that can create a block on top of it. And so after I present the leader election, I'm going to present, you know, the overall system, Fantomate, that is called, that we call a betting scheme, because the idea is like really when you're going to create a block and on top of another block, this will be like similar to betting on that block. And you can think about it in proof of work, it's a bit the same. Like if you mine on top of a block, it's the same as if you were saying, okay, I bet that this block is going to be on the main chain, so I'm actually going to spend money, you know, to create a block on that chain because I think I'm going to get rewarded for this. And the main idea of our scheme is we're going to use like incentives in order to still have this notion of like one block to reach consensus and not have this type of like BFT style consensus protocol. Remember when I was telling you at the beginning of my talk that in traditional consensus protocol we need to exchange a lot of message. So we don't want to have that. We still want to have like one block to reach consensus, and we're going to use incentives for this. Okay, so quickly I'm going to talk about the leader election protocol. So what properties do we want? We want it to be fair. So remember when I talked about chain quality earlier about blockchains, so now it's the same, like we want a player to be, you know, to be elected as often as they should, where, you know, should is, for example, in a proof of stake setting, that will be like proportional to their stake. We also want the leader election to be unpredictable, so it means that other players should not be able to know who is gonna be elected leader before they have seen their proof of eligibility. So this means that, for example, they cannot DDoS a player because they know he's going to be elected leader. And in addition to unpredictability, we also had private unpredictability. And the idea is like you cannot even say for yourself if you're going to be elected leader before a certain time. So you cannot compute your proof of eligibility too much in advance. And lastly, we want liveness. So I've already mentioned it again in the case of blockchain. So it means that we should be able to elect a leader, even if there is an adversary that's tried to make the protocol abort. Okay, so with our leader election, they're going to be associated a random beacon. So a random beacon, for those who don't know, it's a pseudo-randomly generated number. And this random beacon is going to be associated with each block. So it means that each block will have a pseudo-random number associated with it. Now, without going too much into the detail, I'm just going to say how the leader election works. So it is inspired by Algorand. Unlike Algorand, we're going to have an initialization of the random beacon. So again, for those who are like familiar with like cryptography, we're going to do like a coin tossing protocol. So if you know, if you don't know, don't worry, that's fine. But if you know, it's you know, the type of like commit then reveal protocol. So it requires a lot of exchange of messages. So that's why we're only going to do it once for the initialization. Once the random beacon is initialized, we're going to use a verifiable random function, and each participant is going to apply this verifiable random function to their to the random beacon. And if this value is less than a target, then they're going to be elected. So if all of this is like, you know, Greek to you, don't worry, that's fine. Let's just say that this is kind of like a lottery. And if you were at Silvio Micali talks yesterday, so this is like a very, very similar protocol. So also, in addition to that, we add a verifiable delay function, and this is in order to achieve liveness. So the idea is like if no one is elected leader, which can happen with some probability, then we're going to use this verifiable delay function so that player can kind of like redraw the lottery. So again, if this is too technical for you, don't worry, just think of it as a lottery. I'm going to move on now. Okay, so now that we have like kind of like the idea of like the lottery, how everyone is elected, I'm going to present the main protocol. So we're going to use a block DAG. So this is inspired by Phantom by Sompolsky and Zohar. I'm going to explain what it is very quickly. So as I said before, a block is going to bet on its parent block. So this is the same as, you know, in Bitcoin, when you create a block on top of another block, and this is the same as betting on it. So however, here, instead of betting, in addition of betting on a block is going to reference other blocks. So let's have a quick graph to understand this. So here you see like block C was created on top of block A. So C is betting on A. However, C is also referencing B. The idea is like C is saying to other player, look, I'm creating a block on top A. However, I am aware that block B exists, that there is, you know, a fork, so I'm referencing it. So that's the idea of like block DAG, is that you're going to have, you know, one block that just points to all the blocks that they are aware of. So however, there's still like in our setting a notion of chain, because a block bets on its parents and reference other blocks. So these are two different type of pointers. So you see like the blue arrow, this is still the notion of chain. Okay, so now the idea is like each block is going to have a score, and basically the more connection you have within the graph, the better your score is. So for example, here you see that C has way more connection than D, so C has a better score than D. If there is a tie, we're going to break the tie with the random beacon that I talked about earlier. So it means that, for example, A and B, they roughly have the same score. So we're going to say, okay, we need to decide on a block. So we're going to decide on the block that has the smaller random beacon, let's say A. So A is like the winner, and then B is going to become the weaker chain. So the idea behind that is that a block can only reference blocks with smaller score. So it means that here, block D, that is betting on B, cannot reference block A. Because if it was the case, it will be the same as if D was saying, I'm betting on B, even though I'm aware of A. So it's clearly that D is cheating because they are choosing the weaker chain instead of the main chain. So this is really a way to enforce accountability, because we ask player, okay, what blocks do you see? And then, you know, they have to they have to tell us all of the chain they see, and they have to choose the one that is the main chain. So the idea is like the main chain is going to grow faster. So this is really like, you know, the main idea behind the protocol. I'm going to explain it with another graph just to be sure it's clear. So as I said here, AC is the main chain and BD is the weaker chain. So let's say that someone wants to cheat and create a block on the weaker chain. They can do so, but then they have to reference block A, because if they were referencing block C, it will be clear that they were cheating, and so their block will not be considered valid. Now, a block betting on the main chain can reference the weaker chain. So that's really like the main idea. The main chain can reference every other chain, but the weaker chain cannot. So in addition to that, with our incentive scheme, we're going to reward connectivity. So the blocks that have the more connection to other blocks are going to earn more. And also, we're going to punish blocks that are not well connected. And this is how we achieve security. So remember, at the beginning of the talk, I talked about robustness. So just very quickly to remind you, robustness, the idea is like a coalition of players are not incentivized to deviate. And also, irrational players cannot harm the non-deviating player. So if we achieve robustness in our protocol, it's really because players are incentivized to reference other blocks, as I've just said, because it increases their reward. And also, they're more likely to win if they follow the protocol. So really, like everything is made so that players are incentivized to keep on growing the main chain. Also, players are incentivized to publish their block as soon as possible, because if they do so, they're going to get more reference from the other players. So so they're not going to keep blocks for themselves for very long. That's not in their incentives. Okay, so now what about, you know, the other like blockchain security property that I mentioned? So remember, I talk about chain growth, which is like the liveness, the idea that the chain, you know, keep growing, and also common prefix, which is the idea that everyone is going to agree on the chain. So in my paper, I regrouped these two properties into one that is called convergence. So you kind of like get the idea, convergence, it means that every player will just converge towards the main chain. So if this is achieved, it's because the score of the main chain grows faster. So remember, this is why I spent time explaining before, just a few minutes before. Okay, and in addition to this, there is also chain quality. So remember, chain quality, it means that an adversary should not be able to contribute more blocks than what they should, be allowed to. And if this is verified, this is due to the fair leader election. So the idea is like an adversary is going to be, you know, selected by the lottery proportionally to the stake, so they will not be able to contribute more blocks. Okay, so I'm not going to go into the detail of this because I don't have enough time. So if you want, you can look at the paper. But I'm very briefly going to mention that in our scheme, we also add a decentralized checkpointing. And this is to thwart long-range attacks that I mentioned in the beginning of my talk. So this decentralized checkpointing, again, very quickly, it's inspired by two-phase commits. So the idea is like after there is like end of vote and this take like two phase, like players are not going to accept any other chain. Okay. Okay, now I'm also quickly going to mention that in our paper we have simulation. So we kind of like simulated the you know, worst case behavior of like players that are that want to attack the system. So whether they are, you know, rational and they want to like maximize their expectation, or they are irrational and they want to harm the honest players, and I'm not going to go into details, but we verify our formal proof with this simulation. So here you see like the expected payoff of the players. We also have simulation of the longest fork, as well as the fraction of blocks contributed by honest player versus not honest player. So I invite you to read the paper about this. Okay, so very quick conclusion. So in our paper, we use block DAG to enforce accountability. So that's really what I've been explaining, where a player say, you know, I'm aware of all these blocks, and then we can see where they are cheating or not. Also, we incentivize rational players to follow the protocol, and really we leverage incentive in order to have blockchain, you know, that works, that kind of like mimic proof of work. Remember at the beginning when I was saying like proof of work is only like one message broadcast. So we really like using incentive mimic this type of consensus protocol instead of traditional consensus protocol. We have a lot of message exchange. Okay, I'm out of time, so you can read the paper at this link. And also, we don't really have time to take questions. I mean, we don't take questions here, but you have my email address and my Twitter, and I'm also around, maybe not for too long because it's already the end of the day, but feel free to like email me or tweet me if you have like questions or if you want to discuss this more. Thank you.